Obviously, our main aim is the white shark. Again, we again want would have liked the one line, but we push to have those two smaller curtains here to not only detect the presence or absence, because that's what basically a VR2 detect, presence or absence of an animal, but also the direction of the movement, obviously, that toward P or toward Cape Town. Algoa Bay is a very interesting, there's a lot of different animals, there's a lot of interest in this bay, there's Matt and Malcolm, there's Sayab, there's Rhodes, there's OTN now. So a lot of people that are using the same technology. Now, it makes sense to, instead of having each little one working separately, but having all these people working together to have a better, firepower. Sorry if I use this word, but a better detection power. Maybe it sounds much better, more conservation-wise. A better detection power than just having your own little receivers. Then obviously another interesting point was the POTAF, Alfred in the, and as you can see there's some of the, as well here there are a few in the different estuaries, and here as well, few are an estuary here, and a river here, and obviously the OTN line in Port Alfred. Eastern Cape, that is actually here, there's not an OTN line, but it's more, I think this one is those guys here, and Sayab, and, but again, it's not looking just a single project, it's looking at the whole effort. Sayab, collaborative project between Sayab, OTN, Sharks Board, and Jeremy talked about yesterday about this interesting and quite complex to manage site. Okay, there is in Ponta, Ryan, this is the latest one, okay?
Yeah.
And Ryan is going to talk about this one as well in Ponta, in southern Mozambique, and there is as well one proposed in southern Mozambique, just south of Maputo Bay, and I think this is the same one, but anyway. And I think that's Simon and you guys have also up more north. So basically we're covering in this, if we collaborate with each other, we're covering a stretch of coastline which is massive. Okay, again, I had to put some underlines so just to to go through all the things that Paul wanted to say. So what's the job of ADAP? ADAP is function to maintain a national registry of transmitters. So which means with the identification code for each transmitter, as well obviously the species, who put the transmitter, when put, where the transmitter put, how was put outside, internally, externally, etc. Service all the deployed units and maintain a registry of a receiver, and as well their SOC time, because sometimes you put up a receiver and there's not always the next one to come down. So it's quite important to know as well the effort that you have, the listening effort that you have at all the time. Now, this is, Paul asked me to explain it quite clearly now. I'm Italian, so I don't know whether I'm able to explain quite clearly, but I'm gonna try. This is a quite a debated point. And, okay, so ADAP is aimed to download all the receiver and put all the data into a national database. Now, OTN is going to provide a platform to have this a national database basically created. This will be all the initially to see how it runs in Canada, and then it would move to South Africa. So it will become a South African national database created specifically and run by people that know, created by people that know already these issues for South Africa to run those OTN project. Obviously as well, is doesn't end here, because also will be the ATAP will be the link among the different scientists in the different parts, because if you tag an animal in point A and the animal comes in point B, as we've seen yesterday that you guys found a shark that was tagged by Jeremy, but you guys didn't, I mean, you didn't know yet, right? But this is something that I think we need to improve. As if there is someone that is in charge to notify as soon as possible, this is a big improvement in the ability of monitor your data, how's your how the plan of your research is going. So it's very important that this part be as well. Again, collaboration. Oh, jeez, poor. Okay, it's a collaborative marine science program managed as, by SciHub. The receiver are maintained by SciHub, uploaded and stored in a national database. The metadata is basically, it would be available to all the researchers, and I don't know where they decided on term of pushing even further, but mostly will be species and who tag them and who put that tag on that animal. That will be then the researcher that tag that will be informed by the ADAP. There's been obviously, as I said, OTN Canada provide the funding, capital investment for this project, but then to run this project had to have a little kind of different approach. Now, it couldn't be run only by one group, and therefore that was the idea of using the need of different research group in order to make this project feasible in running for many years. So obviously there was the NRF NRF funding as well at the beginning to the development, but then Several Seas Foundation, African Selagant Ecosystem Program, and there was another one that I'm forgetting. No. And there were as well, they put money to, you know, change batteries, put anti-fouling and on all the receivers. And then it becomes also an effort, money-wise, time-wise, effort-wise, by all the different groups that are benefiting from this project. So we have, as you can see, all the other groups. But obviously this list could increase, hopefully will increase even further. Now, as Jeremy pointed out very well, this has the ability to look not anymore at a single project, not anymore a single species, but on a multi-species, and even on an ecological level. This is very important. Just for example, ocean research here with the University of Pretoria, we're trying to secure a postdoc student to come and look at all this system in Mossel Bay from an ecological, modeling ecologically. So, looking at whales, dolphins, seals, and fish and sharks that pass by. I said that I was going to talk about a bit the marine side, more in detail. So how it works, there is 30 to 70 kilos anchor, which you'll see later, galvanized chain with shackles. And then there is this little piece of equipment that in areas where visibility is poor, there's, you know, white sharks, the weather or other sharks, there's, the weather is, the sea conditions are not always nice to dive with, is a very important piece of equipment. Basically, you go more or less on top of this system and you press a button, the interrogator send a signal to this acoustic release, which using electrolysis cut a little piece of wire down here. So the chain remains. A little bit of pollution, but you can see Mosel Bay is actually creating quite a nice reef, and you'll see actually later, which actually can be a side project as well, if you think of all the different areas, what kind of difference in terms of the what comes out from these chains, for example, could be also a project. Anyway, acoustic release, and then the VR2, and on top one or two troll floats. That actually become quite a big important point. I'll show you later. But anyway, so when the acoustic release release the whole system, this is cut, and this whole system is supposed to come out. A dropping, quite nice system where you go toward the position, you have already everything deployed at sea, and you just push a little bit this anchor chain and drops exactly at the position, and it's very simple way to do it. We tried on the side of the boat, and really, besides breaking your back, it was really tough. So this is much better system. As you can see, different kind of deployments as well. Railway line, show later. And this is very nice visibility. We don't have always this kind of visibility. The anchoring system, we different places like huge double chain links, very huge, 70 gauge. Thanks a donation from Petro SA here. The Natasha boy use double anchor heads, more or less 70 kilos always. Also, 50 kilos are a railway line piece, which I think we're gonna move toward this thing. And I don't know who used 150 kilos. I'm very happy that it's not me, because but there is also this option to use a concrete block. This, I think, was also old. I think in the early days, we used a big tire with concrete block and a pole. Again, that you had to dive instead in this case. Okay, that's the theory. Now, in the real world, is not happening always what you expect. Alison told you yesterday that sometimes the species that you study launch you a curveball, you defined it, and does exactly what you don't want to do. What if instead the species that you're studying does that? What about if the equipment that you're using launch you that curveball? Now, what if the equipment decided to move? So you go to the position, I just find it funny this one, and it's not very. You go into the position where you expect the thing to go, and the acoustic release is nice, and it tells you also the distance from the receiver and from the acoustic release. And you read the 2 miles, and you're supposed to be on top of that thing. So 2 miles, wow. And you have a directional hydrophone, so you can't, it's not very easy to track, but obviously, because we're good at tracking, we did it even then. So anyway, what happened? A nice troller decided to come a bit too inshore and picked up our receiver and dropped it 2 miles away. Fortunately, the acoustic release has got a massive range, so that was quite good. But other thing that happened, what if the system that you're using for the float, it doesn't float? So you have, as you can see, we were faced with a dilemma whether to carry on research or making money and creating a muscle farm kind of business. Obviously, we stayed with research, but this is this is something that I think was 6 months, 7 months time, and came up. The float was barely. So we went there and we pressed the thing and didn't come up. Stayed there for 3 hours, didn't come up. Came back the next day, didn't come up. So for 2 weeks, we tried with the anchor, tried to pick it up, nothing. So I'm just saying this because it could be something that everyone might be interested. So at the end, I sent two of my expendable interns to dive down. Actually, not intense anymore. And they dove down. Actually, Mike said, look, it looked like it was his body diver there, because it was massive thing, and it wasn't floating. So the release worked perfectly, But it was lying on the thing, and as you can see, this was very, beside the funny octopus, yeah, but it was very clean. So it's quite, there's nothing here, but all the things was on the float. So the actually, so the idea of having bigger float might not be a good idea. You have to test it again. I definitely not gonna use this. This was a float, two floats of this side. I'm not gonna use it anymore. So I talked to Paul, we're gonna use small ones and work better. So obviously these are the challenges. So to pull it up, those guys put a rope on the receiver, and because they dove about 36 meters, I couldn't task them. Okay, they're expendable, but not so much. So I couldn't task them to even pull it up. So I went basically from this side of the boat with the rope on my back to the other side about 30 times. Until I pull this thing up, and conversely to what Paul is gonna tell you, that muscle do not have any weight on water. I can tell you they have a massive weight on water, at least in Mossel Bay. So maybe there's a different muscle. But anyway, so what's the solution of this one? As one of our intern said, either. Come on, it's supposed to be funny. Either you have me on each of your boat, but it's not very feasible. Otherwise, Paul designed this other system, which is quite nice. Basically, is using a copper sleeve that doesn't allow the growth on the part that actually is supposed to cut. Now, in case of the previous. In the case lack of the float not coming, that's actually won't make too much of a difference because the acoustic release did its job. But anyway, still, if you want me on the boat, this is anyway. Now going back, serious. What's the nice thing of the TON as well, as Tristan showed you, can be mixed with other projects. It can be used at a multi-approach kind of. Methodology. Now, the OSearch was already a collaborative project between that made history in Africa, I would say, in South Africa, at least, but even around the world, where basically we tagged 39 white sharks, different kind of tags. We, as Alison said, there's over 20 papers that could come out. There's PhD, masters, honor studies, even for the future, that can come up from this project. Then we can combine, because obviously we put ARCO tags on those animals, can be combined with the OTN. So this really is something that I hope we're going to see more and more, this kind of collaboration. Now, if you are... this is another example, studying bull shark in South Africa. As you can see, this is the distribution, and these are three places that can collaborate and use this kind of platform to improve the effectiveness of their studies. Now. I know that there's still a lot of, I hope that actually there was going to be a bit of deaf people as well, and different, more of those people along Southern Africa. But, and I know that there's a little bit of, fear, to consider that basically those guys, Sayab, could to give this, collaborate and give this data and be part of this project under basically the OTN umbrella. That could be understandable, but if you look on the bigger picture, what you can achieve by collaborating, by having SASC, Sayab, Sharks Board, all the people in Mozambique, to put the effort together and really try to answer questions globally, or at least regionally, rather than on your little garden is gonna be a massive advantage for everyone. So really I urge to think of the bigger picture rather than the each people interest. This is a classical example of good collaboration. Now, outcome that can come out are amazing from this OTN initiative. There's a special ecology of iconic on the, for the conservation, understanding special ecology of several conservation iconic species, looking at environmental and biological factor that drive the movement of different species, looking at regional abundance, seasonality, looking also at the management of overexploited fishery species. Looking at shark-human interaction mitigation. This is a completely different kind of aspect, but very, very important. Looking at tourism species like the mantas and whale shark in the migratory route between South Africa and Mozambique. Different countries that collaborate to each other for better results. Climate change effects, looking at how the temperature could rise, monitoring, because also the OTN has got little data loggers that can tell you 24/7 the situation, which could, is very interesting for very project. The temperature not only at the surface but also at different depth. And also, as a matter of pride, this really is another kind of collaborative project that puts South Africa in viewed internationally as a success. It will be showcased at the second international the Fish Biotelemetry Conference. And as I told you, yes, it's going to happen in July. And is really going to be portrayed as a success, and it can improve even further in the next years. So I really, urge you guys to think about being part of this project. And I think that's it. Thank you.